Christmas. Morning, come on, let's go ahead and stand together. Hey, in Luke chapter 2, the Message paraphrase says, the angel said, "Don't be afraid. I'm here to announce a great and joyful event that is meant for everybody worldwide. A Savior has just been born in David's town, a Savior who is Messiah and Master. This is what you are to look for, a baby wrapped in a blanket and lying in a manger." And at once, the angel was joined by a huge angelic choir singing God's praises, saying, "Glory to God in the heavenly heights, peace to all men and women on earth who please Him." Let's welcome the Lord with praise. Let's sing.
We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed to adore Him. Let every heart adore. Let every soul awake. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. Let every heart adore. Let every soul awake. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. Yes, Lord.
Put our hands together right here. Looks like this.
We have a reason to wait.
The joy of the Lord is my strength. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let sing.
Thank you. That woman brought an offering of worship and poured it out at the feet of Jesus. And when we gather here in worship, when we sing these songs to the Lord, we're doing the same thing that they were doing. We are just pouring out our worship through song, just adoring the one who came for us adoring the one that is even with us now. Let's sing this again. Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy, worthy is your name. All of heaven joins the universe ever crying. Worthy, worthy is your. I'm pouring out our adoration today. Wonderful Counselor, our Mighty God, our Prince of Peace, our Everlasting Father. That's who you are. So, Lord, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you for who you are. And we adore you in this place. And we just pour out all of our love for you, Jesus. Thank you for your presence. We thank you for your word. And our hearts are so open today, Lord. Our hearts are open. And just like you've met with us now, Lord, we're just expecting you to speak through your word today. We love you. We pray all these things. In the name of Jesus, amen. Amen. You can take a seat.
Hey, and welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. I'm so glad that you've joined us today. My name is Jeff Thompson, and I serve as the lead campus pastor at Harvest. You know, on this final Sunday of 2020, we would love to know where you are watching from today. So let us know in the chat or in the comments. And hey, if this is your first time with us, I want to give you a special welcome just for you. But no matter where you're joining us from today, we are so glad that you are here. Whether you're new or whether you come to Harvest every week, we want to invite you to check in. And you can do that on this page or through the link on the comments or on the Harvest Bible Chapel app on your phone. We would love to know that you're here today, that you're joining us, and we would love to know how we can pray for you and lift you up to the Lord this week. Well, today, our Christmas sermon series, Let Every Heart Prepare Him Room, concludes. And Pastor Eddie Hoagland is going to be opening God's Word, and we're going to be looking into it together. So we invite you to grab your Bible right now and be ready to look into God's Word together. Hey, parents, join us online on Thursday, December 31st from 2 to 4 p.m. to close out 2020 with families all across Chicagoland and even beyond. This is an interactive experience, and it will have activities for families to complete together, led by our party hosts. From Minute to Win It style games, to music, to slime, to farm animals. So come prepared for special guests and a whole lot of fun. Registration is free, but it is required, so we need you to go online and register. You can get all of the details at harvestnow.info. Well, next Sunday, we want to invite you to join us at one of our campuses for an in-person service where all of our campus pastors will be preaching on every campus. And you know, as we come towards the end of the year, we're reminded 2 Corinthians 9, 6 through 8 tells us that the point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. Will you prayerfully consider giving bountifully and cheerfully to the work that God is doing through this church? Because your generous gift to close out the year will help make more gospel-centered ministry possible in 2021. And I want to remind you there are four ways that you can give. You can give online. You can give on the Harvest Bible Chapel app. You can give through text or by mailing your gifts to the Rolling Meadows campus. And all of the gifts for 2020 need to be received or postmarked by December 31st. Would you join me in prayer as we continue in worship? Father, we are so grateful for your incredible love and mercy and faithfulness that you have shown us this year. Even in a difficult year, you have been immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine. And God, we're grateful for the ministry that's happened through our church. It's so much greater than who we are. But it's because of your great name that you accomplish these things. And God, as we come to an end of a year and a beginning of a new year, we pray that you would lead us well through all of that. Lord, we pray that you would take these tithes and these offerings that we desire to give cheerfully and faithfully. We pray that you would use them to further the gospel in Chicagoland and across the world. God, people need Jesus Christ, and we long to see more men and women come into a relationship with you. And so would you do it through our church? Would you do it through us, God? We're so grateful for that. We pray that you would be glorified through all of it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, we long for you. Merry Christmas, Harvest. I feel like I can still say Merry Christmas because you know how it is. You celebrate Christmas with your immediate family in the morning, then you might head over to someone else's house in the afternoon, and day after Christmas, you visit aunt and uncle and second and third cousin, and then 2 days after Christmas, we celebrate as a church family, right? So that's why I think Merry Christmas, because this to me is our church family celebration of Christmas. And you know, I've been thinking about this year how there's a gap between what marketing companies want us to think Christmas shopping is like and then what Christmas shopping actually is like, right? You've seen the commercial where they show this perfectly ethnically diverse family just skipping through the mall, and they're all wearing the same sweater. They're all smiling, the kids are obeying, and everything's on sale, you know, and they're just having a great time, and I wish that was the way it was, honestly. But have you found that Christmas shopping is a little different than that? At least it is for me. For me, Christmas shopping, let's just imagine it. Let's say you head over to Woodfield Mall, and it's late in December, pre-COVID, when there were crowds, and it's late in December, Christmas is coming, and you head over to Woodfield Mall, and then you pull into the parking lot, and there's no parking spots. I know what you just heard is that there were few parking spots, but what I said was there's no parking spots. There's absolutely no spots in that parking lot. So you leave your car in the grass, and you hope it's there when you come back, and then you do your three-mile walk up to the nearest entrance, and then you show up to the entrance of the mall, and there's a, you know, there's a lady with a bucket full of change, and she's ringing a bell, and you walk by her, and she's like, "Merry Christmas!" And it's like, whoa, that's a little scary. I needed more of a warm welcome. And then you walk into the store, and when you walk into the store, have you found that people just aren't as jolly as they should be at Christmas? That's what I find. I find that people are a little bit extra crabby at Christmas. That's my experience, at least. You go in there, and you're like, it's the most... No, it's not. It's not the most wonderful time of the year because everyone's upset because they're stressed, and it's all fun and games until you're holding that last iPod that was on the shelf. And then what happens is Christmas starts to merge with Halloween a little bit. That's my experience. I see that. And then you spend the whole day shopping. You're exhausted, and your body's not feeling super great because for lunch you chose to have a Cinnabon cinnamon roll. And you wash it down with a root beer float, and your body's like, that's not really what I needed. And now here you are hours later sitting down at dinner at Wetzel's Pretzels, and your body's like, could I get something else? This isn't really what I need. So my point is that there's a gap. There's a gap between what marketing companies want us to think that Christmas shopping is and then what it really is. And I think that's the same as the gap that we have today on what people think Christmas is, or honestly what people think Christianity is, and then what it truly is. There's a gap between those two things. And so that's what I want to talk about today. I want to talk to you about the difference between what you might think Christianity is and then what it truly, truly is. And if I were in your seat, and let's say today you're coming for the first time or you're watching online for the first time, you've never seen one of our services. Well, first of all, let me say I'm really glad you're here, really glad that you're here. But if I was in your seat, I would be asking the pastor, could you just kind of tell me, like, what's the, like, summary of what you guys stand for, right? Like, I'm coming to church, trying to figure out, what are you guys all about? Well, that's what I'm going to talk to you today about. It's the core of Christianity, which is called the gospel. That word just means the good news. And I'm going to share this good news with you by using the scaffolding from a song, actually, that we've been singing this whole month. The song's called Make Room. And there's a lyric in the bridge that I think is going to be very helpful in how we're going to walk through this good news today. So the lyric in the bridge says this. It says, "Shake up the ground of all my tradition, break down the walls of all my religion, your way is better." And I just thought that's such a useful way of being able to share this good news with you. Let's talk about tradition, let's talk about religion, and then let's talk about why that lyric says that your way is better. Because I believe those lyrics really hit the message I want to bring to you right on the bullseye. That there are man-made ways of knowing God and having a relationship with him. And then there's God's way. And God's way is better. I believe every human heart knows in its deepest parts that things aren't the way they should be. And there is a longing for peace in your soul that you try to satisfy with anything you can get your hands on. And what that need is salvation. That's what you need. You need to be saved. To be saved from the emptiness that you feel in your life. To be saved from all that is wrong in the world. But really to be saved from what is wrong inside of you. See, to be saved means that you are known by God, that you are his child. So let's answer the question, what does it mean to be saved? How is the way that I can be saved? All right, well, we're going to answer that today. Let's go to Luke chapter 2. I would love for you to be able to see this yourself. Luke chapter 2, if you don't have a Bible, there's a Bible in the seat in front of you, or there should be a Bible under the seat in front of you. Somewhere around you, there's a Bible, and you can go to Luke, the third book in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, then Luke. And we're going to be in chapter 2, studying verses 1 through 7. Now, let me just tell you, normally when I preach, I love just saying, here's the passage we're going to preach. I start at the top, end at the end, and that's the sermon. Today, I'm going to do something a little different. I need you to kind of hold your place there, because that's the passage we're going to look at in point 3. But in point 1 and 2, I'm going to have other passages, but don't worry, I have it on the screen. So we can just watch those verses on the screen, and then when we get to the last point, we'll be able to dive into Luke chapter 2 together. All right, so that is the plan today as we make room for Jesus. Let me pray as we start. Father, I just take a moment right here and just ask that you would use this time that we're going to spend in your word. Use it for your glory. God, do what you want to, for I am not able to change someone's heart. That's not something I can do, but I know that you can. And Lord, thank you that you've changed my heart, and thank you that you've changed so many of our hearts, and we are different because of the work that you've done in us. And so we ask that you would do that here today in the name of Jesus. All God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, here we go. Point one, let's talk about the way of tradition. The way of tradition. Now, let me start by saying, I'm not anti-tradition. I know people who would be anti-tradition. They're kind of rebellious. They don't want to follow any rules. That's not me. I really like tradition, to be honest. I love studying it in other cultures. I'm always fascinated to find out what this culture does this as a tradition, and this culture does that as a tradition. I love tradition, and a tradition can be good, it can be bad, or it could be neither. But to believe that by keeping a tradition, you can be saved, that's when things really go wrong, okay? And this is much like what happened to the Pharisees and the scribes who were the religious leaders in the time of Jesus. So let me take you to Mark chapter 7. This is going to be on the screen, and we'll see this conversation between Jesus and these religious leaders. It says, "Now when the Pharisees gathered to him with some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem, they saw that some of his disciples ate with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. For the Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they wash their hands properly, holding to the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash. And there are many other traditions that they observe, such as the washing of cups and pots and copper vessels and dining couches. And the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, 'Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?' And he said to them," this is Jesus, "Well did Isaiah prophesy of you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men.'" You leave the commandment of God and hold to the tradition of men. So is the point of this passage that Jesus is teaching that you should not wash your hands before a meal, that that's a bad thing to do, that that's an evil thing to do? That, of course not. That's not what he's talking about. He's bringing up the point that when you give tradition the same authority as God's authority, then you end up in a bad place, because that's not the rightful place God deserves. See, people washing their hands, they were doing that believing that they gained God's favor by following that tradition, even though God had never said to do it. And man, that last verse we just read, let's just throw it up there one more time. This is what really stirs my heart. It says, verse 8, "You leave the commandment of God and hold to the traditions of men. That really stirs my heart because I see the connection between the two, that there are people who held to the traditions of men, and that somehow led to a leaving of what God actually said. And that resonates true today. This is happening everywhere in our country today, that people are holding to some traditions, thinking they're obeying what God has said to do, but it's actually them leaving what God has said to do. And that's the danger of tradition, is giving it its wrong place. So let's talk about some traditions that exist in our culture today. One's happening right now. Maybe you have a family tradition of coming to church at Christmas. And I'm glad you're here. I'm glad you're here for sure to hear this message. But listen, coming to church at Christmas, it won't save you. It won't save you. You could come here every single weekend and doing that won't save you. Following that tradition, it won't save you. And maybe your family taught you some good manners and how to be nice to people and do good things. Those are all great traditions. I have some of those in my family. But the point I'm making is those traditions, they don't save you. They don't solve the problem that we have. And then I have to mention this tradition because I see it directly in that passage when he says that they honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. That their heart is far from me. And I just have to mention that one of the traditions that the church has is what's happening today. It's one of the greatest traditions in church history is that we gather every single Sunday. Why? Why do we do it on Sunday? Because we celebrate the fact that Jesus rose on the first day of the week on Sunday. And so it's one of our traditions to gather as God's people on Sundays. And you could be coming every single Sunday to our church, and you could be with your lips singing those songs that we lead you in and giving praise to God. You can do those things and still be far from God. It's possible for that to happen. And that's because tradition won't save you. See, here's the problem. God's standard is perfection. That's God's standard. And if you're not perfect, which, spoiler alert, you're not, but it's okay, you're in good company. I'm definitely not perfect. No one in this room is perfect. So if you aren't perfect, then participating in good tradition, it's not going to save you. Romans 3:10 is just super clear. It says, as it is written, none is righteous, no, not one. None is righteous. He could have just said that and left it at that. But look, he goes farther. He's making it really, really clear for you. No. So if you're arguing with Paul in that verse, he'd be like, no, not one. Absolutely no one has a right standing with God naturally. No one is righteous, not even one person. Why? Because you and I have sinned. So when you sin, that just means you're not keeping God's rules. You've missed the mark on keeping God's law. And like I said, you haven't done it, but I haven't done it either. There's no one righteous, no, not one. So the conclusion that we can have about the way of tradition is that the way of tradition does not lead to salvation. Next, let's study the way of religion. The way of religion. Similar, definitely some overlap, but it's a little different, I think. You know, the word religion actually isn't the easiest word to define. But for the sake of this message, can we just use it for a general term that has anything to do with activity in a religious setting or activity in a church setting? Let's just use it that way. That's what religion is for the sake of this message. Here's the thing. Doing religious things won't save you. And I know for some of you, you came to church and you're like, that's one of the most shocking things I've ever heard a pastor say to me directly. But it's true. Doing religious things, it also won't save you. The Bible is really, really clear on this. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9 say this. For by grace you have been saved. So there's the word, saved. How? By grace through faith. By grace meaning you didn't earn it. God had to give it to you out of his kindness. He had to give it to you by grace. And then through faith, meaning that you would put your faith in God, that you would trust in him, that you would believe in him. And this is not your own doing. Man, that's just so clear. It's saying you're saved, but you didn't do it. It's not something that you did. Salvation is not a do thing. It's not I did this, and because I did this work, now I know that I'm saved. That's what the Bible's teaching. No, it's not that. It is the gift of God. Not as a result of works, so that no one may boast, so that no one can show off saying, see, I did these things and now I'm saved. No one can say that because it's not a doing thing that will save you. And so it makes me think of modern examples of religion and how we think through religion. So maybe you tell me, Eddie, I grew up in a religious family and they took me to church every single weekend and I did all the things they said I was supposed to do, and that might have been your religious family, but look, that won't save you. And maybe you not only grew up in a religious family, you might have grown up in a family that also put you in a religious school your whole life. And then when college came, all your friends went to, they went to party schools and you partied at a religious school, right? It was a slightly different path. And you might think, well, isn't that worth something? Like, isn't it worth something? Well, it might be worth something, but it doesn't save you. It doesn't solve the problem that we have with our sin. And maybe you might tell me, as we're having this little conversation, you might say, Eddie, but I put my money where my mouth is. I give money to churches. I give money to charities and nonprofits. Like, you're telling me that God says, like, that won't save me, that won't bring me into a relationship with him? No, it won't. You can't buy your way into heaven. You can't buy your way into a relationship with God, because that would be a work. That would be a thing that you're doing, and salvation is not a do thing. So even if you were, baptized as an infant by your parents, or you went through confirmation, or you took classes on what the Bible says, all those things. Look, anything that taught you God's word, it could have been a good thing. I'm just letting you know that doesn't save you, because that would have been something you did. It would have been a work. And works, like Ephesians 2 clearly tells us, they don't save you. Here's what I know. You can't earn a relationship with God. Then you might ask me, well, then why do Christians do all these things? If you're saying salvation isn't a do thing, why, when I look at Christians, they're doing so many things? And the answer to that is the difference between the word to and because. See, Christians are doing good works. They're doing good things not to be saved. They're not gaining salvation by doing it, but they're doing it because they're saved. See, when God saves you, it creates in you this thankfulness that you just have to respond. And it's not something that you'll ever repay to God. No, it's simply the proper response is to do things. And so you jump into God's word and you start studying, what did Jesus teach? And then as he's teaching you something, then you do it. And that's what they're doing. They're doing these good things because they've been saved, not to be saved. So our conclusion about the way of religion has to be the same as the way of tradition. The way of religion does not lead to salvation. So then finally this, point three, the way of Jesus. The way of Jesus. Now I know I've been telling you that I was going to give you good news, and so far it might not sound like good news. It's not this, but here's the good news. The good news is that there is a way to be saved. And so many in the world are arguing and they're trying to convince you that there's many ways to God, but that's not true. There's only one way, the way of Jesus. And I'm blown away that there is a way. See, I'm not arguing that we need to have many ways. I'm just thankful and blown away that there is a way to be saved. And it's the way of Jesus. The way of Jesus is that he would come to earth to save people. That he would come to earth, that's Christmas. If you're wondering, what is Christmas? It's that Jesus left heaven and came to earth. That's what we celebrate at Christmas. But why did he come? He came to save people. All right, now, dust off Luke chapter 2. We're ready to dive in now. We're all reading together. Luke chapter 2, starting in verse 1, I'll read this over you. It says, in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph, so this is Joseph who's engaged to Mary, who's pregnant with Jesus. Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And when they were there, the time came for her to give birth. All right, it's go time. It's baby time. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn. Now, that word manger, you might have the picture of what we typically think for the word manger, where you see that, like, you know, the wooden thing with, like, the cross things and then, like, the hay in the middle. You know what I'm talking about? That's our typical picture of manger. You know, most likely that's not what the manger looked like that Jesus was in, because wood in that day was a bit more of a luxury, a bit more that way, not as common as today. So what most of those mangers were made out of, it was normally a large stone that they would just carve out of the top so there would be a dip, and then they could put food in there for animals to eat. So what it was a feeding trough. That's where they placed Jesus because he was in a stable. Why is he in the stable? Because there was no room for him in the inn. And, you know, I've always thought of that word inn growing up, and probably because of all the, like, Christmas pageants I was in, that, like, the inn is kind of like the hotel, right? So it's almost like Joseph and Mary are showing up at the Holiday Inn Bethlehem, and they're saying, hey, can we have a room? And they're like, nope, no room. You can stay in the garage. Like, that's how I always thought of the inn. But come to find out, that word inn is not the word for hotel. And there is a word for that in the Bible, in the Greek, and it's not the word used here. It's a different word. The word here used for inn is much more closely related to guest room. It's a guest room. And see, in this time, there was no room in the guest room because these families would have had a nice room prepared, because you have to remember, this culture is very big on honor. They're very big on hospitality. And so they would have a room that was prepared all the time, ready for their guests, for family members that would be in town. But why is there no room in the inn? Well, that's because everyone's coming to be registered. And Joseph and Mary would not have been probably the couple, if they were going to their family's house, they wouldn't have gotten that guest room. They wouldn't have gotten the nice, and it was probably a really nice room, I would guess, because they were so big on hospitality, probably the nicest place to sleep, probably the nicest location in the house. And that beautiful room was full. And so then Jesus is born in the stable. He was born in a humble feeding trough because there was no room for him in the guest room. And you might think, see, Eddie, I can't be known by God. I have a past. If you knew my story, you wouldn't be trying to tell me this good news, because I'm not good enough and I'll never be. Well, if that's you, can I just tell you, no Christian ever has been or ever will be good enough for God. And figuratively speaking, what I'm trying to ask you is, can you be that manger with all its imperfections and dirt? Can you simply make room to receive Jesus? Jesus was born in that manger, but then he lived the perfect life that you and I, we couldn't live. And the way he saves people is because he chose to die on the cross in their place, so that they could be saved from the consequence of sin. When you break God's law, that sin, and the consequence of sin is death. It's spiritual death. And that's why Jesus dies on the cross in their place, so that they can be saved from that death. Jesus Christ died in your place so that you could be saved from your sin. And that's good news. That is life-changing good news, if you're willing to make room for it. Later on in the book of Luke, in chapter 19, Jesus says this, for the Son of Man, speaking about himself, for the Son of Man came, that's Christmas, but why did he come? He came to seek and save the lost. That's why Christmas exists, because Jesus came to seek and save the lost. And hear me, Jesus is still seeking people today. And Jesus is still saving people today. I want to ask you to turn your attention to the screen. I want to share this video with you of a family in our church.
Hi, I'm Rosalyn Aranas. I'm a neurologist by trade.
And my name is Martin Aranas. We've been married since 2001.
We have an 11-year-old son named Julian. I grew up as a Catholic, but after college, lost touch with God. There was this big void in my life, and I didn't understand why. I thought I checked all the boxes in my life, all the degrees and the house, the family, but deep inside there was this searching yearning.
I grew up with nothing. You know, family having a hard time, not having, you know, food on the tables. So it becomes a mission in my life to have all the material stuff, making sure that my family is safe. It's a constant worry about material things, and that's what my life is like before I found Jesus.
It all started with the COVID. We were unhappy with the full remote learning experience by our son. We decided we wanted to transfer him to a private school, and we ran into a faith-based school. One of the requirements is that we belong to a church. So the next thing we did was to look at area churches that offered online services. And the first online service that we found is the Harvest Bible. I vividly recall that Sunday, everything kind of just went gray around me. All I saw was Pastor Dave talking on the stage, and I thought I was hallucinating. But I thought I saw Jesus standing next to Pastor Dave with his hand outstretched, asking me, it's time to come back home. You've done so much, accomplished so much. Now it's time to come back home. And I think that was the time I decided, text 7979.
And so what I'm gonna invite you to do, if you'd like someone to pray with you, or if you'd like to just talk with someone about maybe questions that you have or next steps in your walk with Christ, you can just text the word follow to 797979. And that's all you need to do, and we'll have someone reach out to you and start that conversation.
Little that I know, I turned to my right where Martin was sitting when we were watching the sermon. There were tears coming down his eyes too, and I didn't realize, but he could tell the story.
Yeah, well, for me, I thought this journey that we were taking was for my son to make sure that, you know, he has a strong faith, a strong conviction. I didn't realize that I could have that too, that it's not too late for me, that even at 50 years old, I you know, I can have that same faith that God still would welcome me. And that's when she saw me crying, and I'm like texting 7979.
I remember it well, because we got a text that said follow, and then we got another text that said follow, and it came from these two right here. And just beautiful, beautiful. But Rosalind.
The next day, we got a call from Pastor John Smith right away, reaching out to us.
Yeah, and that text really means something. When you say follow me, they actually really did take you to this, you know, every single step to follow him. You know, when we transitioned from online to live, in person, it seems like it didn't change. It's just that the location, it's because of the connection that you built with the church. So whether you're online or you're live, that connection is still there.
After accepting Jesus Christ as my Savior, and with the Harvest community supporting me in growing my faith, I can't tell you how happy and overjoyed I am. I've never felt this much joy and happiness with achieving material things or whatever worldly things we achieve in life.
Now we have this I have this feeling of hope and of safety, that as long as I'm doing my part daily, the future, God will take care of it for me.
Amen. What you just witnessed is the work of God himself. Okay, see, Martin and Rosalind, they didn't save themselves. They did not do a work that saved them. And in hindsight, it's just so obvious that God is the one who was pursuing them. God was the one seeking them to save them. And if we could rewind a few months and see what it is that this family was doing, see, they were simply making room. They were just making room for Jesus. They're the ones who were willing to search for a church online. They're the ones who were willing to watch a service online, like many of you are today. And they were willing to attend a service like many of you are today. But then this, they were willing to say yes to the invitation of Jesus to believe in him and to follow him. The way of tradition does not lead to salvation. The way of religion does not lead to salvation. The way of Jesus is the only way to be saved. That is the truth from God's word today. See, I need some of you to stop thinking that you're listening to the sermon by accident. It's not an accident. God is seeking you. God wants to save you, and you can sense it right now. He's stirring it in your heart, and you know that it's time. It's time for you to walk away from the way of tradition. You need to walk away from the way of religion. You need to walk away from your own way. Stop thinking that your way is the way that you're going to make it. No, no. Leave all that behind and find the way of Jesus. How are you going to believe that? What do you need to do? Well, here's what you need to do. You need to know that God loves you. He's always loved you. This isn't new information. You might be finding it out, but God has always loved you, and his invitation to you is this. John 3:16, the most popular verse in the whole Bible for good reason. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Whoever believes in him. Whoever, really, Eddie? Whoever? Yes. Whoever believes in him. And don't make that word a small word, okay? Maybe you think, well, yeah, I've always believed in God. I've always believed in Jesus. No, that's not the belief I'm talking about here. And that's not what John's talking about in John 3:16. We're talking about deep, life-changing belief. That you would believe the things that Jesus said, meaning you believe that he came at Christmas, and you believe that he lived that perfect life, and that you would believe that he died on the cross in your place so that you could be saved, and then you believe that he rose again on the third day to offer you new life. That's the belief I'm talking about. And if that's you, if you're like, yes, I am in on that belief. I do believe that. Well, then I'm going to give you an opportunity to really declare that today. To remember today as a day where you went from not believing to believing. So across all our campuses, I want to invite the leaders to come forward now. I've asked for some leaders to be able to stand at the front of the stage. And here's why. Here's why I asked the leaders to come first. I want you to know that we've all been where you are right now. There was a day where I didn't believe, and then I believed. And I know what it's like to sit in your seat. And so what I'm about to do is I'm about to ask you, if you are saying, today is the day that I believe that Jesus Christ is my Savior, then here in a second, I'm going to ask you to come forward and just meet with one of these leaders. All we're going to do up front, we're just going to pray together, and then we have a gift for you, and that's all I'm going to ask you to do. Just have the courage to be able to come forward here in just a second. Now, if you're watching online, you're not going to be able to come forward, but you want to say that exact same thing, that you today, you believe that Jesus is your Savior, that you are following what his word says, then you can text the word follow to 797979. Just grab your phone, text that word, and by doing that, you'll be doing the exact same thing, just making that declaration that today you believe in Jesus Christ. So whether you're here in one of our campuses or you're texting in online, here's going to be your opportunity. I'm going to ask you now to stand up. If that's you, stand up and just come to the front and come now as the worship team sings over us, you come and make this declaration of faith. Come now.
And I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to. And I will make room for you to do whatever you
second to just sing a bit more, maybe sing that verse in chorus, because I just know across all our campuses, right now there's a struggle happening where it feels like too much of an ask to come forward, and maybe there's someone on a different campus that's saying, hey, I feel like I missed it, I feel like it's over. I'm just telling you, you haven't, okay? At any point, just start coming down to the front of whatever campus you're at, or if you're watching online, you can text that word. We're going to sing just a bit more, and then we're going to pray together here with those in Elgin, and then for sure we need to celebrate here in a bit. But first, let's have the worship team sing just a bit more. Maybe sing that verse.
Here is where I lay it down, every burden, every crown. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down, every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender, and I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you.
Text it in. Let me just lead you in this prayer. This is how we're going to declare that today's the day that you believe. So you can just repeat after me. Say, Father God, I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross in my place so that I could be saved. Thank you for saving me. In the name of Jesus, amen. All right, church, it's time to celebrate what the Lord's done. Come on, give him praise. Amen. Well, across all six of our campuses, I want to invite you to stand up. We are going to sing to the Lord and give him praise for what he's done today.
Shake up the ground, all my tradition, break down the walls, all my religion, your way.
Well, what we heard today is a message that has truly changed my life. It's the message that changed all of our lives, that we were brought from darkness to light, that we were brought from death to life, that we are now new creations because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. And you know, it's not too late to respond to the Lord today. You can text FOLLOW to 797979. We will reach out to you and help you get started in this new relationship with Jesus Christ as you take these first steps in following Him. We want to invite you to join us back here next Sunday at 9 a.m. and at 11 a.m. for the first worship service of 2021. Have a great week. You are loved.